Welcome to another program in our Business and Society series. Today's speaker is a very special person. This is Dr. Robert Audi from the University of Notre Dame. He has a very, very long title, as is appropriate for somebody who's so esteemed in the business ethics community. He's professor of business ethics and professor of management and of philosophy. So they keep you pretty busy there at Notre Dame, don't they? Well, we're really happy to have you here, and we're looking forward to your lecture later on a variety of topics. But what I want to ask you today, Robert, is something that our whole country's been worried about for quite some time now, the big fiscal crisis, the mortgage issue, the massive loss of jobs, the sudden failure of businesses, too big to fail, a disappearance of promised pensions. That one really, really scares me, and I'm hoping TIAA-CREF stays as good as they've been in the past. And all of this has really destabilized us, and I think has really led us to worry about the business world and also about business ethics. I mean, you are a professor of business ethics. Weren't you folks supposed to be guarding us from these kinds of moral collapses that have led us into this mess? Now, I know that people have always given a bad rap to business ethics. People go like, ha ha ha, business ethics. That's an oxymoron if I've ever heard of one. And yet, you know, I can't help but think that at this time in our country, there's never been more of a need for business ethics than now. But there's so much skepticism about it. Do you have any kind of redeeming social value words you can say about business ethics?
There's no quick fix for our problems in business or in business ethics.
I was hoping there was.
But certainly business ethics is not an oxymoron. There's no inconsistency in the idea that there are ethical standards that govern business. And certainly the recent subprime mortgage crisis indicates that better ethics might have saved us a great deal. Now, I don't want to suggest that in teaching business ethics, we can make bad people good. But we have a lot of good people, and I think teaching business ethics can help to make good people better, and it can help them make better decisions. So we teach business ethics in our business schools, some more than others, and we try to role model it, but there's no substitute for good role modeling in ethics from the family to the churches and civic institutions and through education at all levels. So role modeling is absolutely crucial, but we do it better with good training in ethics.
Well, that sounds pretty reasonable, but how does all this business ethics training, let's say at the Bell College, there are excellent courses in business ethics, there's a promotion of business ethics. Is this really being communicated into the minds of future leaders in the world of business such that it would operationalize itself to prevent things like the mortgage crisis? I mean, hey, had some of the leaders of these very, very large banks taken business ethics courses, do you really believe that would have made any difference? Or maybe they did take business ethics courses.
I'm afraid there are people for whom business ethics courses can provide rationalizations, but there are plenty of people who are less likely to rationalize when doing so is transparent. One thing we can do teaching business ethics is make it harder to fudge. We can make it easier to see when gifts go in the direction of bribes, when manipulation goes in the direction of downright fraud. But I don't want to suggest that any one course can dramatically change personalities. but we do better with those courses than without them. And we need a cooperation in business schools in which all the faculty are conscious of ethical problems and of the importance of ethics in making business decisions.
I think you're right about that. You know, one issue I know we want to talk about simply because it's so much in the news and people are really hot to trot about it, and that is executive compensation. And President Obama's really, you know, going to control the salaries, so to speak, or there is talk of bankers and all of that. Do you think executive compensation in this country is simply too high, that these bonuses have gone out of control? Is that kind of money really justified to be given to people? Are they that important, that essential?
I'm inclined to think that executive compensation in the U.S. is often higher than it ought to be, and it's well known to be higher than it is in Europe generally. But we are in a free society, and we don't want to dictate to business how it should best produce good products and compete in the world market. Now, having said that, I'd mention two kinds of things. First, there are process considerations, considerations about how executive compensation is determined. One thing that we're seeing more of is separation of the role of CEO, chief exec, and the role of chair of the board. The board oversees the salary of the CEO. If the CEO is chair of the board, it's much harder to get independent board judgments on the CEO salary. So we need independence of boards, and boards have to be very well informed. There are still problems about criteria of success for an executive. An executive doesn't operate in a vacuum, and it's very hard sometimes to determine what the contribution of a CEO is and what the contribution of the rest of the team is.
Right.
And of course, the economy has its own momentum and its own forces. So not everything that happens in a sector, say the automotive sector, is a matter of leadership in that sector. Although I can't help remarking that in America, you would have thought that the rise in energy prices and the greenhouse gas effect might have come home to automakers in the U.S. sooner than it has. Now, let's also talk about an example. I noted in the New York Times business section, January 25th, some figures about Goldman Sachs, which is an immensely successful investment bank. We're told in the article that Goldman Sachs set aside $16.2 billion, a billion being 1,000 million, to reward the 32,500 employees. Now, the article unfortunately doesn't tell us whether this is just for bonuses or whether it's also for regular compensation. And when we evaluate executive compensation, we have to look at base salary, bonuses, expense accounts, and other factors. I assume, and I read another article that confirms this, that this is bonuses alone, though it should be said that very often for incentive, a company will have more in bonus than it does in base salary. Now, if you take the $16.2 billion over 32,500 employees, rounding out, you get almost half a million per employee. Now, that is a great deal of money. So one thing we ought to ask is whether if you cut that in half and you had about a quarter of a million per employee, you wouldn't, with the $8 billion plus, be able to do something substantial for the shareholders.
Right.
Now, it should be said that executives hold a great many shares. So although an executive wouldn't get as much from dividends, say, as from bonus, there would be a substantial benefit. Now, I would say roughly if you take half the $16.2 billion and you just imagine a million shareholders, I don't know how many there are, but this is a hypothetical number, You're talking about roughly $8,000 per shareholder. That's a significant amount of money. Now, if you're a shareholder, you would like having that. And suppose you had 100 shares, we're talking about $80 a share. That is very substantial. I think what we're going to see, and what we should see, is more shareholder interest in what companies are doing, and more shareholder representation on the boards that determine policy. We don't want to have shareholders running a company by email consultation, however. I'm not going that far. But I think we are in a period when shareholders have to weigh in. So business ethics affects not just the conduct of the executive, but also the conduct of the shareholder and, looking at another dimension of it all, the customer.
Well, it sort of sets up, maybe, if things don't go rightly, kind of conflicts of interest. I mean, the shareholder's basically saying, hey, we want to limit the size of the bonuses because that's the way to increase, you know, our dividends and so on. So you can see all these kinds of new conflicts. Or I think what you're also pointing out is what transparency enables. In other words, were these things not as transparent as they're becoming? The shareholders would never have known exactly what effect somebody getting that much of a bonus has on them. And that even like a modest reduction in the bonus, well, I shouldn't say modest, what you're saying is a 50% reduction of the bonus, would still give the leaders big bonuses, but also give them something. You know, I've never thought of it exactly that way. Of course, I don't have any shares in anything, so that might be one of the reasons.
Well, almost everyone with multiple roles will have conflicts of interest. So ethics is partly about how to deal with conflicts of interest. When do you resign from a board because the conflict is serious? When do you monitor what you're doing carefully to make sure that any conflicting interests don't cause trouble ethically or, for that matter, economically. Now, it seems to me that we don't want shareholders dictating salary to the penny or compensation in detail, but their views should weigh in. A basic principle here is whether those who determine compensation can show that the extra compensation, even when it's very high, benefits everybody, including employees at the lower level and shareholders. If I get less in dividends, in order to retain a CEO who does so much for the stock value that in the long run I'm ahead, I can live with the lower dividends.
Right.
But if somebody is being paid much more than company performance suggests is warranted, I'm going to look much more closely at low dividends or at either shrinking or only very slightly growing share price.
Right.
So there are a lot of variables that have to be reconciled here, and we want as much impartiality as we can get and the control of conflict of interest where we can get it. Now, there's a real conflict of interest when a board member who may be on a salary committee is appointed by the CEO or anyway serves largely under the CEO and can be edged out by the CEO or paid less if less money is available to the board.
Yeah, that kind of conflict I can understand. It seems like this world of business is getting more and more complex. I'm going to ask you another question, and I think it's a hard one, particularly for someone like me, who has a real interest in women's issues and in feminist concepts and ideas. In your book, Business Ethics and Ethical Business, one of the examples you give is marketing. It's the role of a marketing department to sell more of the product. I mean, that's what marketers are about, right? And so let's say they're selling a product and they know full well that they can sell more of it if they make it more enticing to people. And one of the ways of making things enticing in our country is basically by using sexually explicit or suggestive kind of ads. I mean, Super Bowl is coming up, so I'm already looking forward to seeing what the, incarnation of that particular tendency is going to be. Now, the example you give is that if you were in charge of a marketing department, and you were going to sell something by basically tossing out displays of women looking really, good in, the all-American way. And you also had a teenage daughter that you really wanted to promote in her an idea of women as more than commodities. Women as so much better than being a sexual object of certain type.
Right.
And now you're having this personal world versus professional world conflict. You know, you can sell more of your cars by lounging women all over them.
Well, don't we know that?
Well, I don't know if we know it or not.
I think real marketing research is done by very careful investigators, but I am not sure how much less would be made, if less would be made at all, if we improved the representation of the human image in advertising. At least we can say this much. Ethics is concerned with how human beings are represented, and it opposes the commodification of people, either in advertising or in child labor, say in sweatshops, or in any other way. So I would say the following. Ethical business should be willing to take a little bit less in order to represent human beings a little more positively. How much can we ask, however? What if the only way to sell women's garments is to show women in what I think almost anyone considers unflattering poses, though someone must find them material for identification or the goods wouldn't sell. Well, this is a difficult matter, but I really don't know whether our empirical information is as good as it might be. Certainly, we ought to investigate to see whether we can sell our goods adequately while representing human beings, especially women, more favorably than we often do.
And you think that empirical research really hasn't been done or is inadequate?
I'm not an expert on exactly what research has been done. I know there is very good marketing research. I don't know how much people have asked the specific question, can you make women look good in the clothes to be sold without making them look what in many vocabularies would be cheap? And in some cases, I'm afraid that is the interpretation lots of people will put on a number of ads.
Well, right. I was just thinking at lunch, we were talking to Dennis Arnold, the Sertman Professor of Business Ethics here at Bell College, and we were talking about a variety of ways to market pharmaceuticals. And, of course, the standard example of Viagra came up. Now, those are very unflattering representations of men, basically, in all sorts of ways. But, they seem to sell an awful lot of Viagra.
Well, I think Dennis's point concerned airing these things at times when the audience isn't mainly adult.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only comment I'd have on that one. It does matter, though, to whom we're marketing. And let's be clear that if a thing shouldn't be marketed, there's a real question whether it ought to be manufactured at all. Now, should we manufacture guns that evade metal detectors? Who needs them? Not the military, I suppose. What are they for? If the military could make a case that they need them, however, we certainly shouldn't be marketing those to gun lovers.
Right.
They don't need those. They generally don't want them, but we could probably get them to buy these things by marketing them.
Right.
So some things shouldn't be marketed even if they should be produced, and business should consider how marketing is going to be done when they manufacture.
Those are really good points. Another major issue that's been troubling me, and it also is related to discussions in the realm of public policy right now, and I'm mainly thinking of healthcare insurance. Do employers, when I'm thinking about it, really have some sort of, I'm talking moral obligation, to provide their employees with benefits such as health care insurance, pension plans, child care, elder care, whatever you want. To what extent, or why do we think that employers should have those kinds of heavy obligations? Let's start with the health care.
Okay. I think the first thing to say is that what employers ought to do is partly a matter of what government already does. So if we have national health care and it's pretty satisfactory, employers may do less. But there is not just curative health care, there's preventive health care. And it seems to me every business, including very small businesses, can help in prevention. So there is consciousness raising about diet and obesity, about smoking, about exposure to various kinds of diseases. And we can educate about those fairly cheaply. Now, let's suppose government doesn't do enough, as many think our system as it now exists doesn't. Then I think employers who care about their employees, as they should, ought to do all they reasonably can. Now, if I have just three employees and I own my business, and I'm a startup person, I can say, look, I can't at the moment give you health care. You've got to know that up front. Mm-hmm. But if I represent IBM, GE, Merck, it seems to me I can, with the blessing of the shareholders, offer a pretty good health care program, and I think those companies do. There are questions about part-time employees, however. There are questions about what should be done for people whose jobs usually are seasonal. Mm-hmm. It seems to me businesses ought to do all they can here, but we can't ask businesses to risk failure
right.
where they're paying so much for health care with unpredictable costs,
right.
depending on how things go for the employees. And so it's a balancing act.
Like some of the larger automobile manufacturers. I mean, so much of their, funds are tied up in providing, even to people who have retired, the continuation of these very generous benefits that they can just go under basically providing those sorts of benefits. It's kind of a very good thing run amok in a sad sort of way. Many other countries don't think employers have these kinds of obligations. I mean, how do we ever think that employers should have the obligation to provide health care insurance? I mean, where did that idea arise?
People are not machines.
Mm-hmm.
We all understand that. No one wants to be treated like a machine. We are a civilized society. We also believe in a cooperation between business and government.
Mm-hmm.
We want business to flourish. We won't tax it to death. But if we aren't going to tax business as heavily as, say, some of our European cousins, then we can expect business to do a little more for the people, at least if we don't provide them with adequate health care.
That's a really good position you're kind of outlining here, the relationship between government and business. I mean, that's a very deep understanding about sharing the burdens of the citizenry. If both business and government care about people, what kind of balancing act can they achieve
right.
between the two
the
of
American
them?
The American view has generally been the view that business flourishes best when it's free. So instead of taxing executive compensation very, very highly, we rely on the judgment of businesses and the pressures from shareholders
mm-hmm.
to yield a good result.
Mm-hmm.
Now, have things gone too far? It does look that way,
yeah.
Certainly. And the Obama administration undoubtedly is considering raising certain categories of taxation a good deal. Government, however, may be, in general, less efficient than private business. And one argument about health care is we could mandate, as indeed some want to, that businesses provide more and then have government provide less, and we could get a more efficient system. This is a very complex issue. But I would simply say that we want to preserve incentives, mm-hmm. and so don't want to tax any higher than we have to. But in order to provide the services, such as education, which is crucial and very expensive, that a society like ours needs, we have to have taxes. I'm afraid there's just no way out of that. Then there's Social Security.
Do we really?
Alas, we do. Yeah. And there also is the child care and mm-hmm. elder care dimension that goes with health care. And it seems to me a business may do better to offer good child care, even if it doesn't have to. So child care is good ethics, but I would think good business as well. And you can tell that my view in general is that a business that's well-run ethically is likely to prosper better in the long run.
Yeah.
So there might be an exception where someone, by cutting a corner ethically, could have a short-term profit. We can't deny that. But over the long run, businesses do better when they're run ethically. Elder care is another matter. It differs in interesting ways from child care. I mean, you might have Social Security support available, for example. And you might have adult children who don't have their own young children to take care of who can deal with elderly people. But I think elder care, as our population ages, is going to be more of an issue for business ethics and for business itself.
I totally agree. It's going to be more of an issue even than child care. And that might just be in part, what should I say, partial on my point. The older I get, the more I think it's a bigger issue than child care. You know, Robert, unfortunately, I think we only have about one more minute to go. I want you in 60 seconds or less to give our audience a take-home message about your whole philosophy behind business ethics. Can you do that?
Well, I can do some of it. And I would say that I distinguish, and we should all distinguish, between ethical leadership, which we need day in and day out, and leadership in ethics, which we need in the business schools and in business. Leadership in ethics involves putting ethics up front, addressing it, dealing with the standards that we should be internalizing and realizing. I'd also like to emphasize that in the U.S., through decades of prosperity, centuries of prosperity, if you want to look at it developmentally, we may have gotten a little bit complacent, and our work ethic may have drooped somewhat. And I think that ethics calls not just for doing right by others, but for self-development, a quest for excellence. That quest is important in doing business, whether you're on the production end, the selling side, or the consumer side. So as I see it, with the globalization we're experiencing now, and with competition with other nations, if we have ethical business and a good work ethic in which people try to contribute the best they can and not just to do a job and come home at the end of the day and do something else, we will prosper far better.
Well, I think that's a very good note to end on, and we really have appreciated our time with you. Thank you, Robert.
I've enjoyed the conversation. Thank you.